The Chalice Heralds are a loyalist successor chapter of the proud and valiant Blood Angels created during an unknown founding. Most of their history has been lost, and their own records are either incomplete or destroyed. Because of this, they guard their history and only tell those they trust their origins. Despite their laudable history and numerous battle honors, there yet remains a shadow of the Blood Angels' genetic flaw that lingers ever about the Chalice Heralds. With a history of heroism and valor as laudable as some more venerable chapters, it is easy to see why they are heralded far and wide across the Imperium as exemplars of the Great Angel's lineage. They have vanquished foes far and wide, from orcs to Chaos Space Marines, and always upheld the honor of their chapter and founding legion. Much of the Chalice Herald's origin are obfuscated by the midst of time and the long march of millennia. Much has been lost during their long and glorious history, and no one alive is able to pinpoint exactly when they were created. However, extant records indicate that for most of the Herald's history, they were at full strength, but at the start of the 40th millennium, they began to take extreme amounts of casualties. Whole companies were being wiped out one after another. The reason being the current chapter master, Amadeus the Leviathan, was becoming more and more aggressive and reckless. He would send his companies into the most ferocious battles he could find, and when asked why, he simply said, "The Emperor wills it." Soon the chapter was on the brink of extinction, and Amadeus was showing signs of a red thirst. When the head apothecary and high chaplain tried to confront him, he killed them and drank their still warm blood. He then began to reveal his true plan. All the deaths on his hands were to be offered up to the dark gods of chaos, and he would rise to demonhood. But before he could finish his dark ritual and plunge the chapter into madness, the first captain, Uther the Dragon, confronted him and slayed him in mortal combat. Yet, before Amadeus died, he destroyed the chapter's archives and withered the chapter's history. As he did so, and before Uther plunged his chain fist into Amadeus's chest, he screamed, "If I fall, so shall the angels' heralds." After the death of Amadeus, Uther the Dragon took his place as chapter master and had to begin building up what was left of the chapter. Uther covered up Amadeus's true intentions and had it written that he was taken by the Black Rage and died an honorable death so that none would question the loyalties of the chapter. But in this dark time, a light of hope appeared in the form of a vision Chief Librarian Merlius had. He saw an Astartes in the heraldry of the Chalice Heralds reaching for a golden chalice while standing on a pile of red and black corpses. After this vision, Merlius had to be entombed in a dreadnought, but before he lost consciousness, he told Uther that the chalice was a gift from the Great Angel and that if they found it, all of his sons would be cured. At this, Uther dedicated his chapter to finding this chalice by any means necessary. And so he began to change how the chapter operated. He made all companies battle companies and had each company responsible for its own recruiting. Moving on, he made it so companies will no longer be numbered and instead have their own title and heraldry, showing their company upon their right shoulder pad. He then decreed that the chapter will look for anything that will lead them closer to the chalice. And, because of their diminished state, they may scavenge for equipment and keep this fact hidden from all. And finally, Uther made it so that all chaplains will make sure the newly made questing companies will uphold the great quest for the chalice. In their search for the Chalice Heralds have been to almost every corner of the Imperium. Their quester companies have appeared in many battles on many worlds and are known for the willingness to answer to almost any call for aid, and all who they fight beside find them to be an honorable chapter and ferocious combatants. When Commander Dante called all those of the Blood to Baal, the Chalice Heralds answered and sent two full quester companies. There they fought bravely and with honor, but in the end, only one Marine survived. He was the first to see the Primaris reinforcements. Together, they returned to Camoris to report to Uther. When they did, Uther was enraged and said, "I sent two whole companies to Baal, and this is what returns? A shamed champion and strangers in our colors, claiming they are our brothers." After Uther was calmed, he decreed that two new quester companies would be made to replace the ones who were lost. The Primaris were given their own company, and the only survivor of Bol was promoted to captain. After the events, Uther has sent the Questor companies closer to the Eye of Terror, for on Vigilis he discovered more clues to the location of the Chalice. The Questor companies are now trying to make their way into the Eye of Terror, but it is slow going. With the Kays roaming, the Imperium in many worlds is crying out for aid, and the Chalice Heralds now must choose what is most important to them. The safety of the Imperium, or the Chalice they so long for. The Chalice Heralds are known to make use of larger-than-normal amounts of older patterns of armor and equipment in their armory, so much so that it is more common to see members wearing Mark IV Maximus pattern power armor over the current Mark VII and VIII patterns. They also make use of many older marks of weapons, including Phobos, Tigris, and Umbra pattern bolters. Chapter Colors. The Chalice Heralds primarily wear light green-colored battle armor, with the exception of the shoulder pauldrons insets, which are bone color. The Imperialis or Aquila on the Plaston, a chest guard, is also bone in color. Unlike their progenitors, the Blood Angels, the Chalice Heralds are notable adherents to the Codex Astartes. They do not use the same iconography, and unique heraldry common among many chapters are the blood. The color of the shoulder pauldron trim indicates squad specialty, green, tactical, black, devastator, red, assault, silver, veteran, and bronze, command. A black-colored company symbol on the right shoulder pauldron inset indicates the company of an individual battle brother. Squad assignment is designated by the black color Roman numeral on the left polane. Officers and tactical sergeants are designated by a large red-colored vertical stripe painted on their helmet, and the top of their backpacks are also painted red. Officers are also known to make use of bone-colored tabards to designate their senior status and stand out amongst their fellow warriors. The Chalice Herald's chapter badge takes the form of a large, stylized ebony-colored winged chalice tipped as if pouring out its contents, centered upon the field of bone. Chapter Organization. Headquarters. Chapter Command. Uther the Dragon is the head of the chapter and has the final say in all things. He has no company of his own, instead he travels with a company of his choosing and then he will move to another when he sees it is appropriate. He of course is an honor guard made up of the most elite members of the chapter, all clad in relic cataphracty terminator armor, like himself. They serve a dual purpose, to protect and advise their chapter master, and kill him if he falls to either of the twin curses. Reclusium. The Reclusium is separate from the Questor companies, and the chaplains move from company to company, ensuring that the Great Quest is being upheld. The High Chaplain Mordred is in control of all chaplains and has the responsibility of gathering, listing, and safeguarding the chapter's most valuable relics. Only him and Uther are allowed entry into the deepest parts of the Reclusium. Librarius. Because of the actions of Amadeus, the Librarius of the Chalice Heralds is in a weakened state. Like the Reclusium, they are separate from the Questor companies and send their librarians to those companies that request support. The chief librarian is Merlios, who is now in a dreadnought. The only reason he is no longer chief librarian is because he was the one who had the vision that sent the Chalice Heralds on their great quest. The Knights Recluse are members of the chapter who work as messengers, foot soldiers, and bodyguards for the chaplains. They are the eyes and ears of the Reclusium, and it is considered a bad omen in the chapter when the Knights Recluse are around. No one except Mordred and Uther know their identities and how and why members are chosen to join their ranks. Questor companies. The chapter is split into 10 companies. In this they follow the Codex, but they diverge in the fact that each company is a battle line company and is responsible for its own recruiting. These companies are called Questor companies. Companies are titled instead of numbered and have their captain's personal heraldry upon their right shoulder. When a captain dies, his company is given to his successor, or if he has none, given to an officer Uther the Dragon deems worthy. The new captain can then either choose to keep the company title and heraldry or change it in favor of his own. All former heraldry is displayed in the Grand Hall over the sarcophagi of the fallen captains, and the current heraldry is hung above the council table in the Great Hall with the chapter's banner. Chapter Beliefs. The Chalice Heralds believe that they are on a great quest sent by Sanguinius to find the Chalice and cure the sons of the Great Angel. To this end, they will do almost anything to reach this goal. There have even been rumors that they will go to old Horus Heresy battlefields and dig up corpses and vehicles. But these rumors have never been confirmed, and anyone who spreads these rumors always seems to disappear. The Chalice Heralds venerate Sanguinius and try to honor him in all they do and uphold the great quest he has sent them. The chapter despises the twin curses of their father's line and see it as the great angel punishing his sons for failing him. The great quest is his way of redeeming his sons in his eyes. The great quest. The Chalice Heralds believe that they are on a quest sent by Sanguinius to find the chalice and cure the sons of the angel of the red thirst and black rage. To uphold the great quest, the chapter spreads out across the Imperium looking for any relic or information that would lead them to the chalice. After every 200 years, the chapter returns to Herald's Keep to gather together all they have learned and place the relics they found in the reclusium for safekeeping. It is told that one day a member of the chapter will finally find the chalice, and many of the chapter's captains desire to be the one to do it. Rivalries have formed between captains before, but they are always under the watch of the chaplains, for rivalry can push a space marine further than he would push himself, but it can also get in the way of the greater goal of reaching the chalice. Traditions. The Gathering. The Gathering is where every 200 years the whole chapter makes its way back to the Herald's Keep. When they have all gathered, the quester companies begin to compete with one another for a year. As this is happening, the leaders of the chapter gather and discuss the state of the Great Quest and compile what they have learned and found. This is also when the chapter places its dead in the catacombs and, if a captain has died, places his body unslandered in the Great Hall and chooses a successor for him. This is also a time in which the chapter gathers to remember the sacrifice of Sanguinius and praise him. After a year has passed, the chapter once again leaves to continue its search for the chalice. The Oath of Blood. Before every battle, the members of the Chalice Heralds partake in the Oath of Blood. It is a ceremony in which each battle brother takes a knee and draws his combat knife or sword, depending on rank, and then puts the weapon's tip on the ground in front of him and the pommel against his forehead. The brother then slides his hand along the blade and, as his blood drips down the blade, swears to uphold the honor of his chapter, the Great Quest, and Sanguinius. A more complex version of this happens when initiates become full members of the chapter, when a battle brother becomes a captain, and at the end of the gathering, when the chapter as a whole vows to find the chalice. The Chalice Heralds are experts in urban, close quarters, and infantry-based combat. They make heavy use of tactical, assault, and terminator squads in battle, with support from razorbacks, landspeeders, and storm-raven gunships. Tactical marines in drop pods and storm ravens land to take key points, and others riding in razorbacks push forward to support their brothers. Assault marines with jump packs jump from combat to combat, breaking stalemates and disrupting the enemy, while the ones riding bikes run down those who flee. And terminators and dreadnoughts slowly march forward, putting staggering amounts of fire towards the enemy, as razorbacks and landspeeders dart back and forth, using their heavy weapons to destroy enemy vehicles. During all of this, they are bellowing praises to the great angel and crying out their battle cry. The sergeants of squads have to keep their battle brothers in check, for, though they may despise it, the Red Thirst's pull is strong, and there are many times in which Chalice Heralds have broken formation to kill their foes with their hands and have blood-stained their green power armor. After the battle is done, it is a common sight to see a battle brother covered in blood. The point of all this is to never stop moving for long. The Chalice Heralds pride themselves in their ability to never get into attrition combat. If the line stops, then something must be done to get it moving again. Even if it's slow, it must move. The Chalice Heralds never let up the advance, always pushing the enemy backwards, always face to face with them. The Chalice Heralds will always try to get into melee combat. Indeed, members of the chapter take pride in their swordsmanship. There they use chain and power swords to cut and hack their foes with brutal skill, or, if they have no such weapons, will use their combat knives, which are more akin to short swords, to dispatch their enemies, and when something heavier is needed, they use thunder hammers and chain fists to smash and cut their way through almost anything. Camorris. Camorris is a large moon that orbits the gas giant Angel's Beacon. It is considered to be a tribal world, for its inhabitants are barely past what would be considered the Stone Age of Old Terra. It is a barren world where little grows and water is in short supply. The tribes war with each other over the few resources and have to compete with the indigenous fauna. The greatest of these is the Golden Drake, a large, winged lizard creature that is the apex predator of the world. The chapter's fortress ministry is known as the Herald's Keep. It is a fortress built in the center of a great crater, and the fortress itself looks like a castle from the Middle Age of Terra. It is there that the whole chapter meets every 200 years to share what they have learned and to gather information of the whereabouts of the Chalice in what is called the Gathering. The Great Hall is where the bodies of all former captains are laid to rest, and their personal banners stand vigil over them. The Council Table is where all the senior members of the chapter gather to discuss. It is a round stone table that has its center carved into a shape of the chapter's badge. Below the Fortress Ministry is a network of catacombs that connect to various points through the monastery. It is there that the dead of the chapter are laid to rest. Notable campaigns. The taking of High World Gregor. Gadwin the Champion was sent to the High World of Gregor to investigate a mysterious tome that was in the Planetary Governor's private collection. Upon reaching Gregor, they discovered it to be in the midst of civil war, as it appeared that the governor had declared that he would make a new empire with him as its leader. Gadwin wasted no time and immediately sent his newly made Questor Company down to the planet's surface. In drop pods and thunderhawks, they made their way to the center of the hive and the governor's palace. Striking with such speed that the traitors had no time to react, Gadwin and his company cut through the defenses outside the palace. Gadwin then personally led the charge through the palace, his jumper roaring as he crashed through the main doors. The fighting was swift and bloody, but it was a good day for the Chalice Heralds, for there were no casualties and no brother was taken by either the Red Thirst or Black Rage. Once Gadwin reached the vault, the governor was cowering in it. He and his honor guard interrogated him about the tome, but the governor had apparently distorted it after reading it and refused to give up its secrets. To this, Gadwin dragged the governor out of his hole and had him executed for the whole world to see, so that all would know the fate of traitors. The defense of Forgeworld Alpha Nexus. Uther the Dragon and Gyradus the Righteous were on Alpha Nexus upholding a promise the chapter made to the Forgeworld. An Orqua was approaching the planet and the Chalice Heralds were sworn to protect it. To do this, Uther commanded that they would intercept the Orcs before they reached the planet. So the fleet gathered and made for the incoming Orcs, the Dragon Slayer at its head. Soon the two fleets met, and a terrible battle began. The Orc ships tried to break through the Chalice Herald's fleet, but were stopped short and forced into combat. Ships crashed into ships, torpedoes slammed into hulls, and great barrages from broadsides cut vessels in half. As casualties began to rise, Uther and Gyradus ordered that the boarding action would be taken. Together, they teleported on the warboss's ship, but were separated in the process. Uther and his honor guard headed towards Gyradus's locator signal. Clad in cataphracty terminator, they slaughtered their way to Gyradus. But when they reached him, what Uther saw filled him with fury. Gyradus laid broken and bloody at the feet of the warboss, who appeared to be laughing. The warboss then began to say something, but it was drowned out in Uther's cry of rage as he charged the beast, his bolter screaming with him as it shot out a storm of fire. The warboss, not expecting this, was caught off guard and was slow to react. Uther made him pay for his mistake and rammed the maw into the warboss's chest, staggering him. The warboss then swung his cleaver at Uther, catching him in the side, but before he could do anything more, Uther's honor guard attacked and mortally wounded the orc. Uther then grabbed the Xena's head and crushed it into a pulp. Uther then ordered the wounded Gyradus to be taken by the apothecary, and they both returned to the dragon's lair. The remainder of the Orqua was slaughtered, leaving no survivors as to the wishes of Gyradus, who was shamed by his injuries and wanted vengeance.